So who are the ones that are foreordained? Those whom he has called, from the Jews and the Gentiles, both equal, except the Jews had the opportunity first. We're dealing with the fact that all Israel will be saved. But most everybody considers an Israel that will appear at the end of time, at the end of the world. Most people think of it as an Israel like the one in the Old Testament. Of course, we know there never will be one like that, but that's the view. And so because of that view, even wonderful scholars and commentators don't understand Romans 11, to my surprise. I don't think they've really looked at it, which is amazing because they generally do. I don't know, but they don't understand it. Now, of course, it says in Romans 11, 26, it says these words, I want you to understand this mystery. A hardening has come upon part of Israel until the full number of the Gentiles has come in. And so all Israel will be saved, as it is written. Out of Zion will come the deliverer. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob. And this is my covenant with them when I take away their sins. Hasn't anybody realized there's only one covenant God has? The new covenant. Haven't they read in Hebrews, I think it's the last verse of chapter 10, one of the last verses, that this old covenant is already passing, it's obsolete. It's gone. We're not under the old covenant. We are not under law. We're under grace. We're not under the old covenant. When Jesus had the Last Supper, he took the cup and he said, this is the blood of the new covenant in my blood. You can't have two covenants. The old covenant had the blood of animals. Who wants to go back to the old covenant? The new covenant has the blood of Jesus Christ. The blood of animals can never wash away sins. They just covered it in God's sight. We need our sins washed away or we'll never make heaven. Only the blood of Jesus can wash away our sin. Hasn't anybody considered the fact that the book of Romans is also written by Paul, who wrote Galatians 6, verse 16, and how that he said, this is the Israel of God. He's talking about those who are not circumcised by the flesh. Now, all those of natural Israel were always circumcised by the flesh. And even those of this stolen name Israel, because it's a stolen name. Kazars were thieves. They took on other identities. And even in this, they took on the identity of an Israel that they are not. And when we look at Galatians chapter 6, verse 16, it says, going back to the previous verse, for neither circumcision nor uncircumcision is anything. Nothing to do with anything. As for those who follow this rule, in other words, Christians who say, following Jesus Christ has nothing to do with whether I'm circumcised or not, and we know it has. He said, peace be upon them and mercy, and upon the Israel of God. They're the Israel of God. We're the new Israel. There cannot be two Israels. There's only one Israel. Incidentally, in Galatians chapter 4, verses 21 on, you'll see how that the Jerusalem above is our mother. Nobody has a Jerusalem as their mother that is of this earth. And don't, isn't this the war cry of the people who call themselves Jews next time in Jerusalem? It's their mother. the Apostle Paul says that that Jerusalem is in slavery with her children. But the other woman, Sarah, corresponds to the Jerusalem above. She is our mother. We are that Israel. As the Apostle Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 2, he says it clearly. And he was addressing Hebrews of the dispersion who had become believers in Jesus Christ. If you look at 1 Peter chapter 1 verse 1, exiles of the dispersion. There had been Israelites living all over the Roman Empire. In fact, in other places of the world, probably in India and maybe Afghanistan, China, that were not part of the Roman Empire. They were in the dispersion. They were Israelites. This is what Peter said in chapter 2. He says in verse 8, a stone that makes them stumble is Jesus Christ, and a rock that makes them fall is Jesus Christ. They stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. There were many Hebrews and Israelites who were destined to stumble, because God always only had an elect, a remnant. As Romans tells us very clearly in chapter 9, there is an elect with God. So then Peter says, but you believers who are out of Israel, you are a chosen race. It includes us too. A royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, in order that you may proclaim the mighty acts of him in the gospel, who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people. Those Israelites belonged to Israel after the flesh. They still were not a people that God had designed. But now you are God's people, those who receive his mercy. It's not those who follow law. It's those who receive the mercy and grace of God through faith, even in the Old Testament. Because only those would make heaven who looked ahead to Christ. Even as Simeon did when he held the baby Jesus in his hands. He said, now let your servant depart in peace, because mine eyes have seen your salvation. He'd been looking for it. Here it is in the form of a baby. So when we turn to the book of Romans, I'll just go through the book of Romans as I see it. When you go through the book of Romans, you will see it's about Jew and Gentile. Now, I have not heard any preacher say that. I just picked it up because I went through, just leafed it over, and I could see Jew and Gentile. It's about Jew and Gentile in Romans chapter 1 and chapter 2. And then when you come to chapter 3, it's still about Jew and Gentile. He says about the Jews, are we Jews any better off than the Gentiles? No, for we have already charged that all, both Jews and Gentiles or Greeks, are under the power of sin. Why? Verse 19, that the whole world may be held accountable to God. As Paul said once, it is appointed unto man once to die. Man, mankind. And after that, the judgment for Jew and Gentile. And the Jew, according to Romans 1 and 2, will receive a judgment because he didn't follow the law and because he rejected Christ. The Gentile, who never heard the gospel, is nevertheless guilty because it's written in their heart. about Gog and about righteousness, but they refuse to have anything to do with it. Now, when we come to chapter 9, we see this. In chapter 9, verse 4, there are the Israelites. To them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenant, the giving of the law, the worship, and the promises. The patriarchs, and according to the flesh comes the Messiah. But he says in verse 6, for not all Israelites truly belong to Israel. Now this is under the gospel. The Apostle Paul is writing to people and a world under the gospel, because he says in Romans 1 verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, Christ. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. So this is about the gospel, period. And when we come to chapter 9, he's talking about the gospel, period. There were still Israelites. And he said, some of you Israelites, don't truly belong to Israel. And not all of Abraham's children are his descendants. It's through Isaac. The children of the promise are counted as descendants. And you'll find that in Galatians 3, if you read it. And then he said, it's the election of God. He said he would have mercy on whom he had mercy. So he elects certain ones. Then he says, who are you to say, why have you made me thus? Can the clay say to the potter, why have you made me like this? Then he says, in verse 23 of chapter 9, and what if he has not done so in order to make known the riches of his glory for the objects of mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for glory, including us whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles. So who are the ones that are foreordained? Those whom he has called, from the Jews and the Gentiles, both equal, except the Jews had the opportunity first. Then he goes on to talk about, there's a people whom God never said were my people. He's going to call them my people, and he's going to call them the children of the living God. And Isaiah says about Israel, though the number of the children of Israel were like the sand of the sea, only a remnant of them will be saved. Then he says about the stone in Zion at the end of chapter 9. Now we look at chapter 10, and he says this in verse 9. If you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. Then he says in verse 13, for everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Notice the word saved. Now everybody who's saved knows what it is to be saved. We know we're saved by the blood of the Lamb. We know we're redeemed. We know we're born again. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you shall be saved. We are saved from guilt, from sin, from death, from hell, from the wrath of God. Now when you come to chapter 11, look at this. It says these words, verse 26. And so all Israel will be saved. Same Greek word, sozo. So what's Paul talking about in chapter 11, verse 26? Salvation through Jesus Christ. He says all Israel. Now we know that's not natural Israel, because most of Israelites are dead in their grave. They never get a chance to hear the gospel. The Israelites of the days of Jesus who didn't believe are in Hades, waiting to be put into hell. They're not saved. So for all Israel to be saved, they have to come the only way of salvation, which is through Jesus Christ, dying on the cross, rising again, dying for our sins as God. We have to confess him as Lord or God. If we believe in our hearts and confess him as Lord, you shall be saved. God. So in other words, to be saved, there's only one way, because Jesus said, I am the way. So it's him. What did he do to effect salvation? He died on the cross and rose again and went to heaven. And we who believe in him in relation to his dying for us, and that he rose for our justification, and that he's gone to heaven on our behalf, we're the saved. There's no other way, no other people. Now all end timers that I've met use chapters 9 to 11 to refer to the nation of Israel. Oh, the whole nation of Israel? Yeah, that's to do with the end time. That's to do with the Messiah. That's to do with Jesus reigning from Jerusalem. Now I know it's that because I've heard them. That's what they all believe. You would have heard it too. Yet Paul says, so all Israel will be saved, like they were in Romans chapter 10, nothing to do with natural Israel, nothing to do with the temple, nothing to do with 7 years tribulation, nothing to do with 1,000-year reign, only to do with chapter 10. Same word. Everybody doesn't see that. And I just saw it. Because I've heard all that other teaching all my life, and I think right now, I think every shred of what I heard has disappeared. Every shred hadn't disappeared, because I didn't see that till this week. I looked it up. Yes, yeah, saved. Yes, yeah, same word. It's about the salvation of Jesus Christ. Nothing to do with Israel of the flesh or of the natural. Now, I understood chapter 9 all right. I understood chapter 10. I just didn't understand that bit. I understood the rest of it. It didn't dawn on me. It cannot be what they're saying. Because they have to be the saved, like it is in Romans chapter 10. I mean, you can't cut Romans 10 out of your Bible and accept chapter 11 because you want to say something else. It's ridiculous. And then when you look at chapter 11, you see it's to do with the olive tree. There's only one olive tree. You know, I had a Messianic Jew. I met her. She was married to an Australian in Surf City Assemblies of God, maybe 12 years ago. And I talked with her, not much. You know what she said to me? Very arrogantly. Oh, she said, we Jews support you. You don't support us. That's a lie. Our belief is not Judeo-Christian, it's 100% Christian minus everything Judeo. Our Christianity has nothing to do with Jews or Israel or anything else. As an experience, nothing to do with it. Today, it has nothing to do with Jews. She said that to me. This is what the Apostle Paul said. Now he says, in verse 12, their defeat means riches for the Gentiles. How wonderful. What are the riches for the Gentiles? You read about it in Ephesians chapters 1, 2 and 3. The Apostle Paul says these words in the book of Ephesians. Now the book of Ephesians chapters 1 and 2 is about salvation. And then when you come to chapter 3, he says, I'm preaching you the mystery of Christ, that the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body. Of this gospel, I have become a servant. He's talking about preaching the riches to the Gentiles. And he's talking about the wisdom of God, being full of a rich variety, because we have partaken of the riches of Christ. And the riches of the Gentiles is the riches of Christ, about salvation. And so the Apostle Paul says that because the Israelites fell and stumbled, God then brings in the Gentiles. But that's the only in relation to the way he does it. It's not his purpose to do it specifically that way. His purpose is he divorces Israel and takes another wife, the Church of Jesus Christ. And that's riches for the Gentiles as well as believing Israelites. It's riches for the Gentiles. And they're spiritual riches. So then he's talking about the fact that the Gentiles get these riches too, but because they had not been given the message before, they were brought in not as a natural branch. And so the Apostle Paul explains about the olive tree, and he says about the kindness of God, and but the severity of God is towards all those Israelites who fell. Severe judgment. No mercy. No grace. They persisted in unbelief. And he says in verse 23, even those of Israel, if they do not persist in unbelief, will be grafted in. Those of Israel. Not all Israel. Not all Israel. Those of Israel. Not all Israel. Isn't that right? Those of Israel cannot be all Israel. It's impossible. If you're teaching a class of students and you say, those of you who have not done your homework, stand up. It's not the whole class, is it? A certain segment will stand up. The Apostle Paul is talking about a certain segment, not all Israel. It's not all Israel. So if it's not all Israel, it's only a segment, it cannot be all Israel. So all Israel will be saved in verse 26. He's not talking about natural Israel. He's talking about the covenant God made with them, that is the new covenant. Of Isaiah 59, verse 19, 20, and 21, he's talking about the new covenant that is spoken about in the book of Hebrews. We'll turn to the book of Hebrews. Now, in Hebrews chapter 11, there were godly men and women who had faith, but they did not receive what was promised. Because God provided something better so that they would not, apart from us, be made perfect. In other words, you've got the Israelites and you've got the Gentiles. You've got those who were under the law and only those who were under grace. But then when you go back to chapter 8, by speaking of a new covenant, Hebrews 8:13, God at once renders the former covenant obsolete. And whatever becomes obsolete and loses its force is virtually annulled. That's the correct translation. By speaking of a new covenant, God at once renders the former covenant obsolete. And whatever becomes obsolete and loses its force is virtually annulled. It's annulled. It's no longer. There are not two covenants at the one time. The old covenant was annulled, wiped out. And that old covenant was with Israel. Wiped out. Finished. But when we look at Romans, what it says there, you can go back to it. Romans chapter 11 says this, and this is my covenant with them. What covenant? The new covenant. It's the new covenant of Jeremiah that God speaks about. I will give them a heart of flesh and not take away the heart of stone. A new covenant. And then it goes on to say at the end, oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments and how inscrutable his ways. Or how untrackable. You can't track his ways. So we have a wonderful God who has given a wonderful covenant, who has a new wonderful people who will all be saved. Because everybody in the new Israel is a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ and they are saved. So all Israel will be saved because they believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Apostle Paul was talking ahead about those all who would believe. Everybody of all generation who believe in Jesus Christ, even from the Old Testament days, like David and Samuel and many people like that whose names we do not know, because they looked ahead in the sacrifices to see Jesus Christ. They looked ahead to see Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the center of the book of Daniel. Jesus Christ is the center of the book of Revelation. Jesus Christ is the center of the Old Testament, not the nation of Israel. Jesus Christ is the center of the New Testament, not the Church of Jesus Christ. So here is the new nation. All Israel will be saved. Are you in that Israel? Are you saved? If you are not, you can get saved right now by calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved. Amen. Like there were in Romans chapter 10, nothing to do with natural Israel, nothing to do with the temple, nothing to do with 7 years tribulation.